Audible Incorporated presents Debts, Deficits, and the Demise of the American Economy. Written by Peter Tanous and Jeff Cox. Narrated by Russ Offenbach. Chapter 1. It's the Deficit, Stupid. It is common knowledge that the United States owes a lot of money and that our debt is growing. No arguments about that. Where the debate starts and ends is how we are going to manage our debt. Will we be able to repay it? Will we choke on it? Or perhaps, will we grow out of it and move into a surplus, much like we did during the Clinton administration? First, the simple answer. The mounting U.S. deficit, i.e., the amount we spend over and above what we take in revenue and taxes, is a major problem that will result in a financial calamity soon. How soon? We don't know, but soon enough that we need to be prepared for it. Politicians often rail about the massive federal debt we are leaving to our children and our grandchildren. They are right about the debt, and wrong about the timing. Our children and grandchildren will not have to deal with the problem. We will. The crisis is approaching at alarming speed. And that is what this book is about. Let's back those statements up with some facts. Here again, we want to be conscious of the difference between epistemic humility and epistemic arrogance. Epistemology is a branch of philosophy that is about the study of knowledge. In our book, we try to distinguish between what is knowable and what isn't. The future, by its nature, is not knowable, but some things are easier to predict than others. Linear events are easier to predict than random events which are unpredictable. For example, if you have a stack of books and you add a new book to the stack every day, it is fairly easy to predict how high your stack will be a month from now. As you read this book, we want to make the case that our predictions are solidly grounded. This will constitute epistemic humility. Epistemic arrogance, on the other hand, is to us the practice of predicting events that are not supported by existing facts or trends. That would indeed be epistemic arrogance. It would be arrogant to proclaim exactly when our rising national debt will turn into a financial debacle and a stock market crash, but it will likely occur sooner than we think. The national debt consists of all of the securities, bonds, notes, and bills issued by the United States Treasury. As of December 31, 2010, the total public debt outstanding of $14.03 trillion was approximately 94% of annual gross domestic product, or GDP, of $14.9 trillion. How high the debt? If today's national debt is at a scary high of nearly 100% of GDP, how does that compare to the levels of debt in our nation's history? As Figure 1.1 shows, we have come this close only once in the past. During World War II, the debt reached 120% of GDP. The debt was, of course, the result of the massive cost of World War II, and we spent quite a bit of time paying that down. After the war, expenses declined dramatically in the absence of the high cost of waging the war. As a result, the debt also came down. According to the President's budget for fiscal year 2010, the national debt will pass 100% of GDP in 2011, something that hasn't happened since the end of World War II. Today, politicians and pundits rail about the massive deficits and the need to increase revenue and cut spending. Increasing revenue means raising taxes, something no politician wants to be accused of. Lowering expenses is an equally formidable challenge. Where do you cut? Figure 1.2 shows where the money went in 2010. The shaded area to the right shows that over 50% of our budget expenditures are mandatory for things like Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, and the interest on the national debt. These simply can't be cut. Of course, we can tinker with Social Security by raising the age limit for retirees, for example, But most politicians still treat Social Security as the third rail of politics. Touch it and you die. The largest budget expenditure among the so-called discretionary spending categories is defense. Few politicians are eager to justify major cuts in defense spending, particularly in the aftermath of 9/11. That leaves very little room for making significant cuts. So what about raising taxes? Here, the debate gets heated. There is the constant reminder by Dr. Arthur Laffer, with whom one of us, Tanous, co-authored a book, that within certain limits, raising taxes actually decreases tax revenue, and lowering taxes increases tax revenue. The idea is that taxes are about incentives, so if you raise taxes, there is less incentive to take risk, and if you lower taxes, there is more incentive to work hard and take risk. Hence, more people working and building businesses results in higher tax receipts, even if they are at a lower rate. But no matter which side of that argument you take, we all agree that raising taxes is hard to do, especially for politicians who have to agree to vote on it. If anything, this explains why it is so difficult to get out of the deficit morass, that is, until the deficit becomes a crisis and forces drastic action. That is, of course, precisely what we see in our immediate future. The ticking time bomb. Sovereign debt issues in 2010 are estimated to total $4.5 trillion. This sum is triple the amount of average debt issuance by developing countries over the preceding 5 years. U.S. total debt, including debt held by government agencies, has risen 50% since 2006 to over $14 trillion. These numbing numbers start to lose meaning after a while, at least until we put them in some other context. To that end, let's have a look at the trend of U.S. debt in Figure 1.3. Keep in mind, the source of this data, the Congressional Budget Office, which is nonpartisan. Although that doesn't guarantee that its estimates will be right, it does ensure that the projections will not be tainted by political bias. Clearly, the trend is scary. According to these projections, which may well prove too conservative, U.S. debt, external, as a percentage of GDP, will attain 90% in 2020. We believe that benchmark will come even sooner. And what happens when a country's debt reaches the level of 90% of GDP? To avoid confusion, let us reiterate that there are two ways that federal debt is reported. One includes the internal debt, such as borrowings by the government from the Social Security Fund, which is essentially internal bookkeeping. The second method involves only the U.S. external debt held by the public and foreign governments. Economist Carmen Reinhart, who, with Kenneth Rogoff, co-authored the highly praised book, This Time It's Different, 8 Centuries of Financial Folly, Princeton University Press 2009, made the point of how heavily debt weighs on GDP. In an interview with Forbes magazine, Reinhart discussed her finding that a 90% ratio of government debt to GDP is a tipping point in economic growth. When government debt crosses that 90% line, the economy of the country in question has a growth rate that is 2% lower than an economy that has less debt. This is a significant point. As the United States approaches a debt level of 90% of GDP, if history holds and we subsequently have a 2% lower rate of growth, our growth will not be strong enough to sustain full employment and service our debt. This will further exacerbate and accelerate the debt crisis. Table 1.1 shows the Congressional Budget Office CBO estimate of the projected total deficits through 2020. Its estimates are arguably optimistic. As bad as these estimates look, the reality is that they will prove overly optimistic. Here's why. According to the CBO, federal debt held by the public will stand at 62% of GDP at the end of fiscal year 2010, having risen from 36% at the end of fiscal year 2007, just before the recession began. In only one other period in U.S. history, during and shortly after World War II, has that figure exceeded 50%. Looking at the bottom line of Table 1.1, Nominal GDP Percent Change, the CBO rates of growth of GDP seem very optimistic to us and many others. The projected growth rates of GDP in 2012, 2013, and 2014 are all in excess of 5%, ranging from 5.3% to 5.9%. We don't think this is realistic. Most CBO original projections turn out to be wrong. But then again, almost all long-term economic predictions are wrong. Remember that consumer spending accounts for nearly 70% of GDP, with unemployment stuck above 9% and consumer confidence relatively low. How likely is it that GDP is going to grow at very high rates? And if the growth isn't there, revenues will be lower than expected, and the deficit will increase even faster. An aging population and much higher health care costs will push federal spending as a percentage of GDP much higher. What then? The rising debt and the rising cost of debt. In May 2010, Moody's, one of the major credit rating agencies, estimated that the cost of servicing the U.S. national debt could rise to as much as 23% of federal revenues by 2013, assuming much less optimistic assumptions about economic recovery than those published by the CBO. When the debt servicing costs for a nation reaches 18% or more, that country is on the equivalent of a credit watch by the rating agencies. Indeed, none of the major credit agencies wants to see sovereign debt service in excess of 20%. If that happens, the credit agencies will downgrade that country's debt. Might the United States seriously be in danger of a credit downgrade? Well, yes. Interest rates today are at or near all-time lows, so the cost of servicing the debt is also low, and of course, the debt is rising perilously. And, as we have seen, we risk the explosion of new debt as a result of the growing deficits. If interest rates rise, which we believe is certain to happen, and which will be discussed in a later chapter, then we have the double negative effect of higher interest costs and higher debt, adding to our overall costs of servicing the debt. A downgrade of U.S. debt has never happened, but if it does, there is no doubt that such an event would send shockwaves through the world of finance. No one can reasonably predict the outcome if a downgrade occurs, but it is sure to be ugly. Think of plummeting prices of U.S. Treasury bonds and notes. Will the United States default on its debt? In a word, no. The United States doesn't ever need to default so long as our currency remains desirable and relatively safe. We always have the option of the printing press to make more currency with which to pay back the debt. As inflation lurks, we will wind up paying back our old debt with cheapened dollars. This scenario is widely discussed as a possible solution to our towering debt. But is this realistic? Here's the problem. About 40% of our federal debt is scheduled to mature by mid-year 2011. 70% of the debt will mature within 5 years. If investors smell even a whiff of inflation, they will demand higher interest rates when the government attempts to roll over or reissue the debt as it matures. And since so much federal debt is maturing within the next 5 years, it is very important to keep interest rates low in the short term. For a strategy of inflating our way out of debt to work, we would need to have a much higher proportion of long-term debt to short-term debt. Indeed, we can't inflate our way home if inflation causes us to roll over existing debt at much higher interest rates. Doing that just makes a bad problem even worse. Moreover, we also have TIPS bonds, which are treasury bonds that adjust for inflation. These would react swiftly to a rise in inflation since the principal amount on these bonds is adjusted for inflation every 6 months. At this point, however, inflation-adjusted bonds, TIPS, account for only 7% of the total. The fact that 40% of outstanding Treasury securities will mature in 2011 sets the stage for the crisis. But in our view, the chain of events leading to a world stock market crash will start not in the United States, but rather in Europe. Chapter 2: The Crisis Begins. Perhaps you have heard of the pigs, the rather inelegant term referring to a group of countries with fabled pasts, long histories, and some of the most coveted tourist destinations in the world. PIGS stands for Portugal, Italy, Ireland, Greece, and Spain. Today, the PIGS also share a major common problem. They have more debt than they can afford to pay. One of the features the PIGS have in common is that they are all part of the Eurozone, an economic union that uses a common currency, the euro. The euro was incubated in 1992 when European leaders signed the Treaty of Maastricht, which set the stage for a union of major European countries that would adopt the euro as their common currency. The euro itself entered into use in early 2002. In this chapter, we will take you through a brief history of the euro, then move on to the unraveling of the Eurozone and the problems with some of the country's sovereign debt issues that started in 2010. The rise and fall of the European currency. Right from the start, there were clearly two tiers of Eurozone countries. On the one hand, were the developed economic nations of Austria, Belgium, France, Germany, and the Netherlands, which we referred to as EUN. These were the established mature economies of Northern Europe, countries with stable economies and long-established institutions. The PIGS comprised mostly Southern European economies, and while these nations had long world histories, think of Greece, their economies and more recent history were not as established or trusted as much as those of their northern brethren. So it was certainly fair to ask how these disparate nations with widely divergent wealth, economic policies, and institutions might live and thrive together under a single economic union and currency. In the beginning of the union, things worked out pretty well. In the early 2000s, stock markets endured 3 years of declines in the aftermath of the internet boom and bust. The U.S. stock market declined 3 years in a row from 2000 to 2002 after the euphoric internet bubble burst in early 2000. European markets also fared poorly, but a broad economic recovery had begun and interest rates were low. Widespread confidence fueled a surge in consumer buying throughout Europe. Then the combination of low interest rates and rising demand led to a large increase in private debt. This period of prosperity spread from the Eurozone countries to several other members of the European Union that, while not part of the euro currency group, simply pegged their exchange rates to the euro. Among those countries that did so were Estonia, Lithuania, and Latvia. Estonia adopted the euro in mid-2010. With rising borrowing and spending came rising prices. Wages in the PIGS rose almost 6% per annum from 1997 to 2007, while the comparable wage increase in the EUN countries averaged only 3.2%. Had productivity risen more rapidly in the PIGS countries, that might have mitigated the increase in wages, but productivity gains in the PIGS were essentially the same as the gains in the more developed European nations. The result was that unit labor costs in that period rose by an average of 26% in Greece, Portugal, and Italy, and rose only 17% in the rest of the Eurozone, except for Germany, where wages went up by only 3%. Now, if labor costs are rising much faster in some Eurozone countries than they are in others, you can see the trouble coming. The countries with the fast-rising wages will have higher costs and higher prices, and their products will be less competitive. In the United States, during the housing bubble that led to the Great Recession in 2008-2009, housing prices rose 4.6% per annum. Compare that growth to the housing price increases from 1997 to 2007 of 8% per annum in Spain and 12.5% in Ireland. As prosperity thrived on the combination of consumer spending and low interest rates, tax revenues for the European governments also rose. Predictably, alas, it is true all over the world, when government revenues increase, so does government spending. In retrospect, what the European governments should have done was realize that these higher tax revenues were the result of a cyclical boom. With that understanding, they should have put some money away for a rainy day. But of course, they didn't do that. Figure 2.1 shows the annual growth of government expenditures in the Eurozone countries from 1997 to 2007. Ireland leads the list with an astounding 10% annual growth in government expenditures, and four of the pigs occupy the four top spots. The country with the least rise in government expenditures over that period was, not surprisingly, Germany, the most economically powerful country in the Union. Following this period of prosperity, beginning in the late 1990s, a period of slower growth ensued. At many of the pigs, where spending by both government and the private sector was lavish and prices rose on the heels of high demand, the slowdown began. Portugal and Italy were first to feel the slowdown, and their deficits increased. Greece's fiscal mismanagement contributed to annual deficits of 5% of gross domestic product GDP starting in 2000. Under European Union rules, budget deficits may not exceed 3% of GDP. As the housing crisis, which hit the United States hard, spread to Europe, housing bubbles in Spain and Ireland became particularly severe and required large government interventions, exacerbating the deficits in these countries. The economic slowdown and rising costs also made many of the pigs less competitive in international markets. Add to that the growing debt in these countries and the rising cost of servicing the debt, and you have the makings of an impending and predictable crisis. In spring 2010, the euro crisis began in earnest as the financial community began to question Greece's ability to repay its debt. The snowballing crisis grew and grew. The euro sank to a four-year low, and the downward spiral caused the international financial community to mount an emergency rescue package. In May 2010, the European Central Bank and the International Monetary Fund, IMF, put together a Herculean Greek rescue package of 750 billion euros, which temporarily calmed the markets. Now, the problem starts to take shape. We heard about all of the great advantages of a monetary union like the Eurozone, and indeed, when it started out in 2002, economies flourished. But now, the weaker countries, the pigs, and a few others that linked their currency to the euro, like Estonia, Lithuania, and Latvia, faced a big problem. In most countries that have their own currency, when an economic slowdown occurs, the central bank can adopt a number of measures to alleviate the crisis. The most common measure is to lower interest rates and make credit available to stimulate economic activity. But the three little pigs, Greece, Spain, and Ireland, which desperately needed to stimulate their economies, were unable to do so because they were part of the Eurozone and had no control over interest rates. The strong versus the weak. By contrast, consider Germany's development since it joined the Eurozone. Germany's exports have risen more than those of any other country in the European Union. In the process, Germany became the world's largest exporter. Since other regions of the world have grown faster than the Eurozone in recent years, Germany's exports to the Euro area have declined while increasing to other parts of the world. A number of other characteristics have strengthened Germany's economy, while many others in the Eurozone have declined. Germany is the fifth largest economy in the world in purchasing power, according to the CIA World Factbook 2010. The country recovered smartly from the 2008 recession and expected GDP growth of 3.5% in 2010. However, not all of its neighbors are pleased with Germany's economic path. Germany is one of the most productive exporters in the world, which is, of course, good for German business. However, Germany's neighbors complain that Germany has not encouraged enough domestic consumption, which would benefit neighboring countries, which are net exporters. The point we want to make is this. As some of the countries in the Eurozone ran into serious economic problems, other stronger countries were experiencing growth and prosperity. Since they all shared a currency, though, the countries that needed economic solutions involving lower interest rates and looser monetary policy were unable to use these tools because they were a part of an economic and currency union whose member countries had widely disparate economic circumstances. Think of children who grow up in the same household. Years later, one of the kids is rich and famous, and the others are struggling. They may all want to fly to Tahiti for a family vacation, but only one of the siblings can afford to do so. Tension ensues. In the past, when a country's economic situation got out of line through mismanagement, a spending binge, or other mistakes, the country had, as a last resort, the option to devalue its currency, or worse, default on its debt. In recent times, we recall the case of Argentina, which adopted both of those drastic measures. Indeed, Argentina devalued the peso in 2002 and saw it decline by 70% against the U.S. dollar. The devaluation resulted in a default on 75% of Argentinian foreign debt. Argentinians suffered huge inflation, and many tried to change their currency into dollars. Unemployment rose. Mobs set fires and attacked businesses, especially American businesses like Coca-Cola. Drastic measures like that are not soon forgotten by the international financial community. Today, Argentina still has little or no access to the financial markets, and its Standard & Poor's rating is among the worst in the world. Now, the Euro nations do not have the ability to devalue their currency since their currency is not their own, but one shared by 16 nations. Unfazed by the crisis, Estonia adopted the euro currency in mid-2010. Default, however, is still an option, but it brings terrible consequences for the other nations that share the currency. If one eurozone nation defaults, the financial community immediately turns its attention to the next weakest country. This is how the pigs got lumped together as a group of potentially worrisome debtors, preventing the fire from spreading. We tend to toss around words like default without digging deeper into what it might mean in particular circumstances. In the world of debt, a default simply means that a debtor does not meet its obligations, which include paying interest on time and paying the debt back at the maturity of the loan. But when nations talk about default, they tend to use less dramatic words like restructuring and rescheduling, which sound more like changing a scheduled appointment than defaulting on your obligations. Restructuring and rescheduling mean mostly the same thing. A debtor will announce that it is not going to pay back the loan under the original terms agreed upon. That is, in fact, a default. In a pure default, it will simply announce that it is not paying back the loan, period. The more likely event is that a country will announce that it can no longer afford to pay the debt and is reducing the principal amount owed by, say, 50%. So if you lent this unfortunate country $1,000, your debt is now worth $500, which is the new amount the country will repay you. Oh, and it may also decide to extend the maturity. You lent them the money for 5 years. Well, now you'll get repaid in 10 years. Finally, that interest rate they promised you was awfully high, wasn't it? So, the promised interest rate of 8% is now reduced to 4%. Sorry. And what can you do about it? Well, if you borrowed from a corporation, you and the other creditors would be entitled to put the corporation into bankruptcy and liquidate the assets to try to get your money back. Sell the factory, sell the land, auction off the other assets, and hope the proceeds will cover what you are owed. But in the case of sovereign debt, what do you do? Repossess the Parthenon? Not likely. So investing in the debt of sovereign nations involves a range of risks and advantages. The advantage is that sovereign nations rarely default. The disadvantage is that when they do, there is not a lot you can do to get your money back. This is the beginning of the crisis. When investors become concerned about one or more countries' sovereign debt, you have the potential for a monumental crisis that could spread like a forest fire. This process began with a Greek crisis in mid-2010. In order to protect our assets and intelligently prepare for what is coming, we need to carefully analyze what is likely to happen next. The Greeks have a word for it: default. In December 2010, an IMF report on Greece estimated that Greek debt would reach 347.2 billion euros in 2011, and that gross debt as a percentage of GDP would soar to 152% in 2011, from 141% in 2010 and 127% in 2009. The country's interest payments are rising rapidly as a result of the mounting debt burden and the higher interest rate investors are demanding to hold Greek debt. In 2012, by some estimates, Greece will be paying 17 billion euros in interest alone, up from 12 billion euros in 2009. Based on projections that may well prove optimistic, Greek debt will peak at about 350 billion euros in 2014, at which time the interest payments will be at least 20 billion euros, and probably much more due to the likelihood that interest rates will rise. The IMF projects that Greece will have to borrow 70 billion euros in 2014 if everything goes according to plan. The problem is both stark and simple. Greece's dire financial condition resulted in the imposition of harsh austerity measures as a condition of the massive loans by the IMF and the European Union that bailed the country out in May 2010 through the establishment of the European Financial Stability Facility, EFSF, which, along with the IMF, provided a 750 billion euro safety net for member states. But those austerity measures virtually ensure that Greece will not be able to grow fast enough to earn the funds it needs to pay back the old debt and get the country back on a solid footing. In late January 2011, a creative idea was floated in European financial circles to allow Greece to buy back its bonds at a discount. Given the flow of bad economic news emanating from Athens, Greek sovereign debt traded at a significant discount to their original issue prices. Indeed, in January 2011, Greek 10-year bonds traded at about 70% of their original issue price. So the EFSF would be wise to consider lending Greece the money to buy back its own bonds at a significant discount. Buying back Greek debt at a 30% discount from the issue price would reduce the country's debt burden by the same amount. However, there was some debate as to how much such a measure would help Greece. For one, this scheme requires sellers willing to take a big loss on their holdings of Greek debt. How many of those are there? One analyst, quoted in the Financial Times on January 20, 2011, stated that Greece would be able to save only 12.5 billion euros on its debt through the buybacks, which would bring its estimated debt-to-GDP ratio in 2013 down from 158% to 153%, a barely noticeable improvement. So Greece is barreling down the track, headed straight to a train wreck. Greece will default. But when? We think we know the answer. Now let's consider when and how the next crisis will occur. There are some interesting clues and facts we can use to speculate on both the timing and the events that will inevitably unfold as Greece heads toward default. First, we look at the nature of Greece's deficit. In 2009, for example, Greece had a primary deficit of 20 billion euros. That means that before paying a single euro in interest payments, Greece was 20 billion euros short in covering its internal obligations like pension payments, public services, and other necessary expenditures. Now, it makes sense that Greece does not under any circumstances want to default if its budget is so bad that it can't pay the daily bills and keep the lights on and the buses and trains moving. It must get to the point where it can survive as a nation based on its internal budget, since after a default, it will be highly unlikely that Greece will be able to borrow any money, including the funds to fulfill its internal obligations. Based on the austerity measures imposed on Greece by the European Union and the IMF as conditions of the May 2010 rescue package, which was part of the 750 billion euro IMF-EFSF package, Greece should be on a path to reduce its deficit so that by 2012 or a bit later, the primary deficit of 20 billion euros will have turned into a small surplus. Remember, the primary deficit excludes interest and principal payment on the country's debt. So if all goes according to plan, sometime in 2012, Greece will be able to meet all of its internal obligations. The trains will run on time, the lights will stay on, salaries will be paid, and all the other financial obligations of government will be met. But the remaining financial obligation is a very big one, servicing the external debt. By 2012, Greece will likely be spending 17 billion euros just to service the debt, and that sum will rise to an annual expenditure of over 20 billion euros. To put that sum into context, 20 billion euros is very close to the amount Greece will spend annually on government salaries. Now, let's jump ahead to 2012 or 2013. You are the Prime Minister of Greece. You have to explain to your constituents, the Greek people, that while you recognize that they have suffered tremendously from the austerity imposed on Greece over the past 3 years, you must now spend an enormous amount of Greece's wealth to repay the debts owed to foreigners. Indeed, a series of Greek sovereign bond debt is maturing next week, requiring the payment of principal of 1.5 billion euros. What might you do? You confer with your cabinet and determine that the needs of the country are great. Schools are overcrowded, public servants have endured salary decreases and no subsequent wage increases in several years. Roads and bridges are in such disrepair that they have become a safety hazard, and pension demands are rising and cannot be met under the austerity plan. And, oh yes, in addition to the 1.5 billion euro payment now due, the country owes this year 17 billion euros in debt service to the bankers of Europe. The likely course of action seems painful but obvious. Greece can meet its basic needs, but not for long. A restructuring of Greek debt will save the country at least 10 billion euros a year and allow the country to recover. Restructuring is painful, but like growing old, the alternative is worse. A decision is made. The Prime Minister makes plans to phone the President of the European Central Bank to inform him of the decision while the Minister of Finance prepares the plan for the mandatory restructuring of the debt. The initial thinking at the Finance Ministry is that a haircut of 35% of principal will be imposed, meaning that for every 1,000 euros invested in Greek debt, the new face amount will be reduced to 650 euros. Debt maturities will be extended to 10 years, doubling the average maturity of the existing debt. Interest payments will be brought down from an average of 7.5% to 3%. And so the crisis begins. Aaron, go broke. Ireland was one of the pioneers of the euro, joining the currency union in 1999 and along with the 11 other nations who initially formed the Eurozone, began employing it as currency when the euro started trading in 2002. The economic growth of Ireland in the 1990s is a legendary tale. The country had been one of the poorest in Europe when it transformed itself into one of the fastest growing in the world. A major contributor to Ireland's meteoric growth was a decision to lower the corporate income tax rate. At 12.5%, Ireland undercut the tax rate in the rest of the EU and attracted considerable new business. Other countries were furious, notably the French, who continually pushed the Irish to increase their corporate tax rate as part of their economic recovery. Ireland's growth was also fueled by Ireland's emergence as a financial center, along with the growth of its banks and a corresponding real estate boom. The EU contributed to the economic miracle through huge transfers from the EU structural and cohesion funds, which are the EU's policy instrument, to even out the living standards among EU countries. Ireland soon became known as the Celtic Tiger. Between 1997 and 2007, home prices in Ireland rose by 400%. In 2008 in the United States, the real estate bubble was in full burst mode. A major American investment bank, Lehman Brothers, was allowed to fail, and a severe sense of panic prevailed throughout the financial community and beyond, right down to Main Street. About the same time, Ireland's real estate bubble also burst with dire consequences. The Celtic Tiger was whimpering. Ireland's six largest banks soon faced the precipice. As the crisis unfolded, bad loans, mostly in real estate, devastated the portfolios of the largest Irish banks. In late 2008, the Irish government was faced with an urgent decision. It appeared that several Irish banks were on the brink of failing. What to do? If one bank failed, there would be a run on the other weak banks, and the entire financial system of the country would collapse. So the Irish government made a difficult decision. It guaranteed all of the liabilities of the six largest banks in Ireland at a cost of 400 billion euros. The amount was later bumped up to 480 billion euros to cover the liabilities of some foreign-owned banks with major operations in Ireland. This measure gave some temporary relief. Soon, a stream of bad news started to flow from the Irish banks, raising a new set of fear and concerns. Irish bank stocks tumbled over the following weeks. The government responded to the steep declines in Ireland's bank stocks by announcing it would invest up to 10 billion euros to recapitalize them. In January 2009, the Irish government declared it would invest an additional 7 billion euros to recapitalize the two largest banks. Later that month, the government announced plans to nationalize Anglo-Irish Bank, the largest bank in Ireland, and the problems were still just beginning. Over the following months, Ireland's financial condition worsened, and so did the balance sheets of the Irish banks. Two more banks were nationalized. In October 2010, Ireland's Minister of Finance effectively nationalized the country's second biggest bank, Allied Irish Banks. As a result of the huge amounts of money used to bail out virtually Ireland's entire banking system, the country's budget deficit rose to 32% of GDP, or 10 times the amount allowable by the European Union for its members. Comments in the press called for withdrawal from the Eurozone. Indeed, if Ireland had its own currency, it could help solve its problems by devaluing the currency. By 2010, Ireland's 300,000 public sector employees had endured a 15% average pay cut over the previous 3 years, while the government's budget, once in surplus, declined dramatically into deficit. Figure 2.2 shows the budget deficit approaching 32% of GDP in 2010. Ireland's plan is to get back to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.